Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar Series, where great professors teach you. My name is L.J. Ganser, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled Human Anatomy, The Beauty of Form and Function. Your professor is John K. Young, a professor of anatomy at Howard University, where he conducts research on the hypothalamus, the part of the brain that regulates eating, drinking, and sexual behavior. In 1998, Professor Young won the Kaiser Permanente Award for Excellence in Teaching. He is a member of the American Association of Anatomists, the Endocrine Society, and the Society for Neuroscience. Professor Young has published more than 40 articles in scientific journals and is the author of the books Hormones, Molecular Messengers, and Cells, Amazing Forms and Functions. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin Human Anatomy, The Beauty of Form and Function, Lecture 1, Introduction to Anatomy and the Axial Skeleton. And now, Professor Young.
Hello. The object of this series of lectures is to introduce you to the basic components of the human body and determine how they function together. The human body represents a very interesting assortment of different structures. These structures are the biological equivalents of motors and pulleys, of pumps, of air processing systems, of water purification systems, and of course there's a wonderful command and control system of the body in the form of the central nervous system. So all of these structures are very interesting in themselves. They're intrinsically interesting, and I think it's fun to learn about them and read about them. One of the remarkable things about lots of these structures is that they have the ability to continue to function for many, many years without any problem. And if they do experience some sort of a injury or disease, very frequently a lot of these structures can repair themselves and continue to function just as well as before. However, of course, throughout the course of our life, we can run into some problems, we can have injuries or diseases, and sometimes these structures in the body can't repair themselves and need medical assistance. You may require surgery or medicines to correct the functions of some of these structures. And I think in this case, it's very important for everyone to have a basic understanding of how some of these things work so that we can understand better what medical treatments are available to correct them and what procedures are necessary to restore us to health. So basically, I think it's important for everyone to have some understanding of the human body, both in terms of just for entertainment value, it's interesting, and also because it's a practical benefit. We need to know how our bodies function so they can become corrected. Before we begin on the basic subject of this first lecture, which is going to be the axial skeleton, I want to clear up one basic problem we have, and that's the problem of terminology. Anatomists use particular terms to discuss and describe the human body in a very accurate and precise way. And some of these terms are familiar to everybody, but some of them are a little less familiar, so it wouldn't be a bad idea to go ahead and review some of these terms before we proceed. Some of the initial terms we want to use are ventral and dorsal, and all of us probably are familiar with these terms. The dorsal part of the body is the back of the body, and if you've ever watched a nature show and say that the fish has a dorsal fin, then you realize the dorsal surface of the body is in the back. The front of the body is called the ventral surface of the body, and that refers to your tummy or your face or the anterior parts of your legs. So these terms might be somewhat familiar, but additional terms are a little less familiar to everybody. For example, the midline of your body, the central portion of it, is called the axis of the body, and the skeleton that forms this axis is, of course, called the axial skeleton. Now, some portions of the body are relatively far away from the axis. For example, your shoulders are far away from the axis, and they're called lateral structures. They're in the lateral portions of your body. On the other hand, some structures are a little more close to the axis. For example, the collarbone of the body is closer, and that would be medial to the shoulder. So we have lateral structures and medial structures. Now, when we talk about the limbs, we have to also be precise about what they do. For example, when you bend your arm, so you move your hand closer to your face, that action is called flexing the arm. On the other hand, when you straighten your arm out and point to something, that action is called an extension of the arm. In addition, you can move your arm relative to the axis of your body. And let me give you an example. Let's say if you raise your arm from a from where your hand is positioned close to your leg and straighten it out and extend it and point to something far to your right, that movement of the arm is called an abduction of the arm because you're removing it from the midline of the body. On the other hand, when you straighten out your arm and move it back to your body, that movement is called an adduction of your arm. All of these types of terms are incorporated into the names of muscles in the body. So it's important for you to remember these terms so that we can describe what the muscles are like later on. There's a few other movements that you are also useful to know. For example, you could position your entire body in space in two different ways. For example, if you throw yourself flat on the ground and lie with your back on a carpet, your spine is in the in contact with the carpet, and that position is called a supine position. On the other hand, if you roll over onto your tummy and put your tummy flat against the carpet, then that position is an opposite position called a prone position. And you can do this not only with your whole body, but you can move it and do it with the palm of your hand, for example. If you extend your hand outward and put your palm facing upwards toward the sky, that position is called a supine position of your hand. And if you turn your hand over and put it so the palm is face down, that's a prone position. And there are muscles called supinators and pronators that help you accomplish these movements. So this basically concludes what we need to know about anatomical terminology. And if you bear some of these names in mind, pronate, supinate, extend, flex, then the descriptions that I'll be making about muscles and movements will be a lot clearer in the future. Well, all right, now we've covered some anatomical terminology, let's go ahead and talk about the basic subject of this first lecture, which is the axial skeleton and the muscles of the axial skeleton. First of all, let's define some terms. A skeleton in the body is basically a rigid collection of highly mineralized structures, bones. And most of the animals on Earth have a skeleton, but some animals don't. Worms and octopuses and other animals that float around in the water don't really need a skeleton because they don't have to resist gravity. They can float around and use their muscles to move around easily because they don't have to worry about gravity interfering with their movement. Human beings, of course, have to walk on dry land and they need to stand upright. And to do that, we need to have rigid structural elements that resist gravity, and these elements are pulled on by muscles, and they act as levers so that we can move around. Now, these are not the only functions of the skeleton. The skeleton also acts as an armor plating. The bones of the skull and the bones of the vertebral column enclose very delicate structures like the brain and spinal cord and protect them from damage. So this is kind of like a protective function of the skeleton. And finally, the skeleton acts as a metabolic reservoir. It serves as a site in the body where we can store calcium. So the skeleton acts as kind of like a calcium bank. If blood levels of calcium fall too low, then we can make a withdrawal from the calcium bank and raise levels of calcium in the bloodstream. On the other hand, if calcium in the bloodstream is too high, we can make a deposit in the calcium bank. And therefore, this offers us a metabolic reservoir of calcium that preserves a steady level of this very important element in the body. Well, let's talk about the elements of the axial skeleton. And to do that, we have to begin with the skull. The skull is composed of several different compartments. One of the compartments of the skull is the so-called cranium, a mass of curved plates of bone that enclose the brain. A second part of the skull is the face, of course, and then the final part of the skull is the jawbone or mandible. All of these different parts of the skull have different named bones and different functions. Let's discuss these in a little more detail. Well, if you look at the bones of the skull, they're basically a collection of curved plates of bone. And usually when we talk about anatomy, it's very helpful to have a drawing or a model to describe what these bones look like. And I've used some drawings that I've incorporated into the printed material that comes along with these recordings. But in actual fact, when we discuss anatomy, it's not always necessary to use a model or a drawing because you're all carrying around your own model of the human body right with you. You have your own human body right in front of you, so to speak. And so it's not so hard to actually palpate or feel the elements of the body that we're talking about. And we can begin this process by looking at the skull. The bones of the skull that enclose the brain have their own individual names. And the first bone we can talk about is the frontal bone, The bone that you feel on the front of your forehead is the frontal bone, and it basically represents the anterior part of the skull. On the other hand, the bone at the back of the skull, just above your neck, is called the occipital bone, and it encloses the brain from the posterior part of the cranium. Now, if you go ahead and take your fingers and put them in a ring around your ears, then you're describing the extent of the temporal bones, which enclose the ears on either side of the skull. And incidentally, if you happen to be listening to this recording while you're driving, I want you to keep one hand on the wheel at all times. At any rate, so you can feel the temporal bones on either side of your head, and then if you move your fingers higher up, you can come to the top or crown of your head, and then the crown of your head is occupied by two bones called parietal bones, the left and right parietal bones. So these are the basic bones that enclose the cranium and support the brain. Now, one of the bones that occupies the cranium is not so easily palpable, and this is a bone called the sphenoid bone. This occupies the floor of the cranial cavity and supports the bottom of the brain. And it has a very irregular shape. It kind of looks like a bat or a butterfly that makes the floor of the cranial cavity. It's pierced by numerous holes called foramina, which admit blood vessels up into the brain and also allow the passage of nerves that come out of the brain to innervate parts of the face. So this basically describes the cranial cavity of the skull. Now let's go ahead and talk about the bones that make up the face. There are 14 bones in the skull that form the face, and many of these bones have rather complex shapes and anatomies. 9 of these bones, and there, I can give you the names of them, are basically occupying the interior of the nose and the oral cavity, and they're very difficult to see from the outside. These are the nasal bones, the lacrimal bones, the palatine bones, a bone called the vomer, and bones called nasal conchae. I'm not going to describe them in any detail right now because they're almost impossible to examine unless you actually take the face apart. But the other bones of the face are more easily distinguished by just looking at a skull or feeling the bones of your own face. The remaining bones of the face are the maxillary and zygomatic bones. The zygomatic bones are easily palpable because they make up the cheekbones. The zygomatic bones are palpable just underneath your eyes. They form the margins of the orbital cavity just below it, and they're responsible for forming your cheeks. The two maxillary bones just beneath them are the bones of the upper part of the face that contain the upper teeth. So the maxillary and zygomatic bones are the ones that you can feel in the front of your face. Well, that concludes the description of the bones of the skull. We only have to talk about one more bone, the mandible, which is a large lower bone that makes up the jawbone. It's the bone that the lower teeth are inserted into, and it articulates with the skull at something called the temporal mandibular joint, or TMJ. Occasionally, people can develop some problems with the TMJ. The joint can become unstable or painful, and this is a sign of that may require some medical attention. Well, now we've covered most of the bones of the skull, let's go ahead and talk a little bit more about the remainder of the axial skeleton, which is composed of the vertebral column. In mammals, the vertebral column is composed of a specific number of vertebral bones. Each vertebral column contains 7 bones of the neck, or 7 cervical vertebrae, 12 bones of the back, or 12 thoracic vertebrae, 5 bones of the lower back, or 5 lumbar vertebrae, and 5 bones of the bottom of the axial skeleton, or the sacrum. A good anatomist can distinguish the vertebral bones that are present in each one of these regions of the vertebral column, because each one of these vertebral bones has specific structures and specific anatomies that allows an anatomist to describe where it's from. When you look at all the bones of the vertebral column, they all have a number of features that they have in common. If you take a vertebral bone out of the vertebral column and put it on a table, you'll see that it's divisible into 2 parts. One of the parts of each vertebral bone is a spool-shaped portion, which is called a centrum. And this is the weight-bearing portion of each vertebral bone. So the centra are stacked up upon each other like a big pile of spools. And this pile is the weight-bearing portion of the vertebral column that bears up the weight of the head and all the other parts of the body. Now, sprouting from the dorsal surface of each centrum are 2 little processes that fuse with each other to form a triangular-shaped space. These processes form a structure called the neural arch, and the neural arch forms a triangular space that encloses the spinal cord, the part of the nervous system that extends down into the back. The neural arch will typically have a little spine that proceeds from the dorsal part of it, and you can feel these little bumps along your backbone if you palpate your neck with your fingers. As a matter of fact, if you move your hand along the back of your neck, eventually at the bottom of the neck, you'll run into a large bump, and that bump is the spinous process of the seventh cervical vertebra. So that's the landmark that distinguishes the bones of the neck from the bones of the thorax. One of the interesting features of cervical vertebrae is that they're quite distinctive, and they're easily distinguished from all the other vertebrae in the body, and that's because they have a small hole on each side of the centrum. This hole represents a passageway for large arteries that carry blood up on either side of the vertebral column. These arteries are called vertebral arteries. They're surrounded by the bony armor of the spinal of the vertebral column. And these are important blood vessels because they are major blood vessels that supply blood up to the brain. So the holes that admit the vertebral arteries and allow them to go up to the brain are quite distinctive features of the cervical vertebrae, and a good anatomist can spot them right off the bat. If you move down the vertebral column and look at some of the other vertebrae, you'll notice that the thoracic vertebrae also have a distinctive feature. They have processes that sprout out laterally from each centrum. They're called transverse processes. And the reason that they're there is that they act as buttresses that help attach the ribs to the 12 thoracic vertebrae. So these anchor the ribs and support them and make sure that the ribs are aligned properly. And each thoracic vertebrae has some of these nice transverse processes. The ribs attached to all of the 12 thoracic vertebrae curve around the anterior side of the body until they eventually terminate on another bone called the sternum. And of course, the ribs are there to enclose the lungs and to provide a rigid external framework for the pleural cavity so that the lungs have a nice stable structure to expand and deflate in. As we move down the axial skeleton, we run into additional vertebrae of the lower back. These are the 5 lumbar vertebrae. They're distinctive because they have very large centra, and that makes sense. The lumbar vertebrae are carrying the weight of all the body that's above them, and so the farther down the back they get, the larger they have to be, just like the blocks on the bottom of a pyramid have to be bigger than the blocks on the top of a pyramid. So the lumbar vertebrae are quite distinctive because they have very large centra that bear all the weight of the body. Now, one of the remarkable things about mammals is that the numbers of vertebrae in the axial skeleton are pretty much constant. All mammals on Earth have 7 bones in their neck, so that a mouse can have 7 cervical vertebrae, even if it has a very tiny neck, and a giraffe also has 7 cervical vertebrae, even though it has a very long neck. So the number of vertebrae in these various body segments is pretty much fixed for a mammalian species. Now, that isn't true of other types of species. Reptiles can have quite variable numbers of vertebrae, and if you look at the skeletons of dinosaurs that you can see in museums, you notice that a brontosaurus can have 10 to 20 cervical vertebrae. So in many animals, the number of vertebrae per body segment is somewhat variable. But in mammals, they're pretty much constant. And that probably relates to the fact that all mammals are probably descended from a common ancestor, and the basic body plan of that ancestor has been maintained throughout evolution. Well, one of the questions you might want to ask yourself about these vertebrae is, why are they all so different? And why are the vertebrae located in specific segments of the body? The human body, like the body of many mammals, is highly segmented, and each body segment has its own specific features. This is actually kind of a useful feature of the human body and other mammalian bodies because throughout evolution, it's allowed animals to adapt fairly easily to different environmental changes. If an animal needed to develop a longer neck so it could reach leaves more easily, it was possible to just change a couple body segments rather than the entire body to achieve this goal. So by focusing on changing individual body segments, evolution is made much more easily and animals are much more adaptable. So it's very useful to have a segmented body like human beings have. But where do these body segments come from? Well, for a long time, anatomy was just a descriptive science. We could describe what the body looks like, but we didn't really have any idea of the forces and the signals that created these features. But nowadays, embryologists have identified some of the figures, the signals that are taking place during embryogenesis and which create the different body segments of the body. We now know that during embryogenesis, a slowly developing embryo acquires specific DNA binding proteins that are located in sequential stripes all along the length of the body. And as the body starts to develop more actively, these DNA binding proteins target specific genes in each body segment and turn on the genes necessary for the features of that particular segment. So in the segments of the body of the thorax, these genes stimulate cells to form ribs. In the neck, they stimulate the genes to form the cervical vertebrae and other structures. This whole family of DNA binding proteins is a family called homeotic proteins. And if these homeotic proteins are altered experimentally, they can have drastic effects upon the shape of the body. For example, if you alter the homeotic proteins in the neck that guide the development of cervical vertebrae, you can cause mammalian embryos like mouse embryos to develop ribs in the neck. Or you can cause some of the abnormalities in the jaw and other structures. So the appearance and the knowledge about these homeotic proteins has given embryologists a great tool to understand how the body develops. And these are explanations for why the vertebrae differ between one body segment and the other. Now, if you notice, the vertebral column is relatively flexible. For example, you can bend your back forward and backwards, so you can have some flexibility in your back. And also, you can rotate the vertebral column around its axis slightly. For example, if you're sitting in a chair, you'll notice that you can move your right shoulder anteriorly and your left shoulder posteriorly. And that's because you can rotate the vertebral column along its axis somewhat. Now, it's not really a great deal of rotation, but it's a little bit of rotation, and it adds up because you have lots of vertebrae. Why is this possible? Well, the reason that you can flex and bend the vertebral column is that each bone of the vertebral column is separated from each other by a pad of fibrocartilage called an intervertebral disc. And these intervertebral discs are slightly flexible. So that allows some flexibility of the spinal cord and the vertebral column. One thing that's noteworthy about the vertebral column is that some parts of it are much more flexible than others. As I said before, you can rotate your shoulders somewhat, a little bit, maybe about 20 degrees on either side. But your head is much more easily rotated than the rest of your body. You can look from one side to the other and basically rotate your head almost 180 degrees. So your head has an amazing ability for rotation, which is very helpful for the functions that we have to do in life. What accounts for this unusual freedom of rotation of the skull? Well, the solution to this question is the very unusual anatomy of the first two vertebrae of the neck, the first two cervical vertebrae. The vertebrae that holds up the skull on the very top of the vertebral column is given a special name. It's called the Atlas, after the Greek god who held the earth in his arms. The Atlas is a very strange anatomy. It doesn't look like any of the other vertebrae in the body, and the reason for this is because the centrum for the atlas is completely missing. The atlas has a neural arch, which encloses the vertebral column, but below the neural arch, instead of having a bony centrum, we just have a kind of a flexible, tough ligament. And then below this ligament, we have a big open space, so that the atlas, the first cervical vertebrae, more or less looks like a lifesaver with a band across it. Another peculiar cervical vertebra is called the axis, which is the second cervical vertebra just below the atlas. The axis is a little more normal in appearance, except it has one peculiar feature. The centrum of the axis, instead of being spool-shaped, has a big spike coming out of its upper surface. And that spike, which is called the dens, penetrates into the opening of the atlas. So basically, the atlas is positioned to rotate around this large spike. And that allows us the ability to freely rotate the head on the vertebral column. So the reason for this freedom of movement comes from the very peculiar anatomy of these first two cervical vertebrae. Now, why do these cervical vertebrae come to appear this way? Apparently, what happened during evolution is that the centrum of the atlas, which was originally a normal, ordinary-looking centrum, became detached from the atlas, and instead fused to the centrum of the vertebrae directly beneath it, which is the axis. So the dens process that sticks up like a spike from the axis is really the centrum of the atlas, which became detached from it. We don't know exactly how this came to be. Probably there was a change in the homeotic proteins that dictated the anatomy of the cervical vertebrae. And this was very helpful for mammals because it allows us a great deal of freedom of movement of the head. This particular anatomical arrangement is not universal. In fish and amphibians, which apparently had not evolved enough to accomplish this feat, there is no atlas and axis, and their vertebrae are relatively rigid and they can't rotate very well. So if you look at a fish or a frog, you notice it really doesn't rotate their head very much, not nearly as much as mammals or reptiles or birds. Well, generally, the vertebral column of the axial skeleton functions quite well. Occasionally, we can have some troubles with it. Not infrequently, the intervertebral discs can become worn out and rupture. And when they do that, they can sometimes penetrate into the cavity containing the spinal cord, and that occasionally can be very damaging. The ruptured disc can press upon nerves or can press upon the spinal cord itself and cause lots of nerve damage. Another problem with the vertebral column is a condition called scoliosis. In scoliosis, the spine changes its curvature. Normally, when you look at the back of an individual, the spine basically makes a straight line proceeding all the way up from the pelvis to the head. But in scoliosis, the spine starts to take on an S-shaped curve rather than forming a straight line. Now, this isn't necessarily terribly damaging, but if it progresses for a long period of time, the curve can be quite severe. And about 2% of the population will develop scoliosis. Occasionally, spinal surgery is necessary to straighten this curvature out. And this is a very complex and difficult surgery in which metal rods are attached to the vertebral bones and align them so they have a straighter position. We're not precisely sure what causes this condition, but recently genetic investigators have found a gene called CHD7 that seems to be involved in the production of this curvature of the spine. CHD7 seems to be a protein that affects the function of the homeotic proteins of the spine, and therefore these proteins may be involved in the development of scoliosis. The axial skeleton ends at a structure called the sacrum, and the sacrum represents a triangular-shaped mass of bone that originally started out as 5 separate vertebrae, but which basically fuses to form one solid structure. The sacrum is penetrated by a number of holes or foramina that let nerves out of the spinal cord, and it's connected to the pelvis by ligaments. The sacrum inserts itself into 2 fan-shaped bones of the pelvis, and you can feel the upper surface of these bones. These bones are called the iliac bones, and they make the dorsal margins of the pelvis. The ligaments that insert the sacrum into the ilium are kind of ingenious because they slant downwards, and therefore when the sacrum is pushed down into the pelvis with a great deal of weight, let's say we pick up a big box, and the weight that we're bearing with our arms increases, well, this pushes the sacrum down into the ilium, and it wedges it harder into the pelvis, and that makes the joint between the sacrum and ilium more stable. So it's an anatomically ingenious process that does this. The pelvis itself is composed of 3 bones, the iliac bones, or the ilium, on either side of the vertebral column. And then the iliac bones articulate with other bones called the ischial bones. The ischial bones have downward projecting, rounded processes called the ischial tuberosities. And if you happen to be sitting down when you're listening to this, you can feel the ischial tuberosities because these are the bony structures that we sit on. So they're easily palpable with your fingertips at the bottom of your pelvis. The anterior or ventral portion of the pelvis is composed of 2 bones that meet in the midline, and these bones are called the pubic bones. And together with the ilium and the ischium, they come together to form the pelvic basin. The outer surface of the pelvis contains cup-shaped cavities. Each cavity is called the acetabulum, and these are the cavities that the bones of the lower leg are inserted into. Well, this basically concludes our description of the skeleton of the axis of the body, and we want to touch a little bit about some of the muscles that move the axis of the body. Now, in this series of lectures, I'm not going to try to even name all the muscles in the body. There's something like 146 named muscles in the body, and it would be tedious and even boring for me to relate all these names of all these muscles. But some of the muscles are major muscles, and it's appropriate for you to learn some of them, just so you can understand how some of these structures work. When we talk about the muscles of the skull, we can identify two large muscles that are quite important. One of these you can feel by putting your fingertips on your temples and then clenching your jaw. When you do this, you can feel a muscle bulging there, and that muscle is called the temporalis, which originates on the side of the skull and inserts into the jawbone. There's another muscle called the masseter, and the masseter arises from the zygomatic bones of the cheeks. And if you put your finger below and in front of your ear when you clench your jaw, you can feel that muscle also expanding and contracting. There are lots of muscles that operate the structures of the face. They're called the orbicularis oris, which surrounds the mouth, and the orbicularis oculi, which surrounds the eyes, and they all work together to create the facial gestures that are very common in life. Some of the muscles are very tiny but have very long names. For example, there's a muscle that pulls up the upper lip at the corner of the mouth, and this has an extremely long name called the levator labii superioris aliquinasi. Even though it's only the size of a rubber band, it has a very, very long Latin name. And it basically corresponds to the name, in English, the elevator of the upper lip that's alongside the nose. Now, when you look at some other muscles that are present in the axial skeleton, you can also palpate them very readily. For example, if you put your palm of your hand on your forehead and then try to nod your head, at the same time, if you touch the medial portions of your clavicles, you can feel long tendons that go up from the front of the neck toward the back of the skull. These are tendons that belong to the sternocleidomastoid muscles, and these muscles are the muscles that are responsible for nodding your head when you're nodding yes. Another muscle that's at the back of the neck is called the splenius. This muscle helps bend the neck backwards or help rotate the head, and it covers over deeper neck muscles that also adjust the positions of the skull. There's a large collection of back muscles that go all the way down the spine. They have a number of different divisions. All these muscles, in short, are a collection of muscles called the erector spinae. And these erector spinae muscles help us to arch the back and to move the back as a coordinated whole. Sometimes these muscles of the back can develop spasms and cause people intermittent and severe back pain. And since these muscles are so complex, it's sometimes rather difficult to treat these muscle spasms. So they're a real challenge for physicians. Well, that completes our description of the axial skeleton. In the succeeding lectures, I'd like to talk about muscles of the upper and lower limbs.
This ends Lecture 1. Human Anatomy, Lecture 2. Bones and muscles of the arms and hands.
In this lecture, I'd like to describe to you the bones and muscles of the upper extremity, or the arm. Now, when you take a look at the scheme of the arm, one of the things you might want to conclude right off the bat is that the most important bones of the arm might be the humerus or the radius or the ulna, these long limb bones that are quite visible in any skeleton that you take a look at. And if you were to put these bones at the top of the list, I think you'd probably be making a mistake, because there's another very important bone of the upper extremity that you might ordinarily ignore or forget about. And the bone we're talking about is the shoulder blade, or the scapula. The scapula is a kind of a curved plate-like bone that has an overall triangular shape. And you can feel the scapula just by passing your arm over your shoulder and reaching around to find a kind of a large ridge on the back. This ridge corresponds to a spine that extends along the width of the scapula from the medial side to the lateral side. And this spine is an important part of the scapula because it's an area where muscles are attached to the scapula. This spine of the scapula ends in a large knob called the acromion. And this knob-shaped portion of the scapula forms the upper roof of the shoulder. The scapula is very important for the upper extremity because without the scapula, the arm would fall off of the body. The arm is articulated onto the scapula, and the scapula holds the arm onto the axial skeleton. One of the curious things about the scapula is that it's not really articulated on the axial skeleton very tightly. The main reason why the scapula is attached to the body at all is that it's floating in a big mass of muscles that insert into the scapula and connect the scapula with other bones. So the scapula is kind of a freely floating bone that's very, very flexible, and that allows for a great deal of flexibility, the upper extremity. This unusual anatomy of the scapula makes it possible for us to move our arms upwards and downwards and backwards and forwards with a great deal of flexibility, and that makes it very helpful for us to manipulate things in three-dimensional space. When you look at the scapula carefully, you'll notice that it ends in on its lateral surface with a cup-shaped depression on its lateral surface. And this depression is called the glenoid fossa. And the fossa basically represents the socket of a ball and socket joint. The ball-shaped portion of the ball and socket shape joint is formed by a mass of bone called the head of the humerus. And the humerus is the bone that represents the bone of the upper arm. The humerus is articulating with the scapula, once again, in a very flexible way, and that allows a wide range of movement of the humerus. And the remainder of the humerus, the upper arm bone, represents kind of a cylindrical mass of bone that's a very strong structure. Now, if you move your thumb and forefinger along your upper arm from your shoulder down to your elbow, you'll notice that when you get to your elbow, you'll run into two sharp points on the medial and lateral surfaces of your upper arm. These sharp points are called the medial and lateral epicondyles of the humerus. And they're points that represent the terminal part of the humerus. On the epicondyles, we have attachments formed by ligaments. And these ligaments connect the upper bone of the arm, the humerus, to the lower bones of the arm, which are called the radius and ulna. If you also run your hands along the back of your arm, you'll run down until you get to your elbow. And at the dorsal surface of the elbow, you'll run into a large movable point. So when you flex your arm, this point, which is the point of your elbow, will move. This is a process that comes out of the ulnar bone, and this process is called the olecranon. The reason that we have this big bony process at the elbow is to increase the surface area of the bones of the lower arm, and that allows muscles to insert into this area to help move the lower arm. Also, when you move your fingers along the medial epicondyle of your elbow, you'll notice that just lateral to this medial point, there's a little groove that's located between the olecranon of the ulna and the medial epicondyle. This groove contains a number of structures, and one of the structures that passes along in this groove is a large nerve called the ulnar nerve. Now, normally you don't notice the ulnar nerve, but if you happen to bang your elbow against something by accident so that you hit your funny bone, you'll experience a big burst of pain that radiates down your anterior part of your arm and ends in your little finger. This tingling and burning sensation comes about because when you hit your elbow, you're compressing the ulnar nerve that extends down into your forearm, and that causes a momentary abnormality and sensation. Now, the distal end of the humerus is designed to articulate with the two lower bones of the forearm, the radius and the ulna. Which is which? Well, if you hold out your hand as if you're going to shake hands with somebody and your thumb is pointing upwards to the sky, the bone on the lower surface of your arm is the ulna, and you can feel it with the tips of your other fingers. I always remember that the ulna is the bone beneath the arm. It's the underneath bone. So the ulna and under start with the same word. The ulna articulates with the humerus in a little process that forms a hinge joint. And this process of the humerus is called the trochlea. It's kind of a spool-shaped process on the end of the humerus. And the ulna kind of wraps around this trochlea and forms a hinge joint. So it's a very strong, stable joint, which is very helpful because you don't want to have your lower arm dislocated very easily. The other bone of the forearm is called the radius, and it gets its name because of its peculiar movements. You can feel the radius once again by reaching outward to shake hands with somebody, and the bone that's on the top of your arm is the radius. The radius functions as a rotator of the hand, and therefore it has the ability to rotate along its own axis. If you stick your hand out to shake hands with somebody and put your thumb pointing straight up into the sky, you notice that the upper bone of the forearm is called the radius. And the radius is called the radius because it has the ability to rotate along its own axis. That allows you to put your hand palm downwards and your hand palm upwards. And the reason that's doing it is the radius is rotating and crossing over the ulna. The radius has the ability to rotate like this because it articulates with the humerus at a ball-shaped spherical process called the capitulum. And when the radius is moved, it basically rotates along its axis. So this allows you to pronate and supinate your hand, to flip it from palm side down to palm side up. And all this is, of course, accomplished by muscles called pronators and supinators that move the radius in this direction. Well, when you move your thumb and forefinger down along your forearm, eventually you're going to get to the end of the radius in the ulna. And the radius and the ulna are marked by little bumps on either side of your wrist. And these bumps are called the styloid processes. And these styloid processes, once again, are points of attachment for strong ligaments that hold the hand onto the forearm. Well, when you've this basically describes what the structure of the forearm is. Now let's go on and describe some of the structures in the hand. The hand is a complicated organ. Each hand contains 27 different bones. Fortunately for you, we're not going to name them all. But many of these bones are rather similar in structure, and they can get general terms that describe them. For example, the bones of the fingers are called phalanges. And the thumb has only two phalangeal bones, whereas each one of the other fingers have three phalangeal bones, of course. So you can see the difference quite easily if you hold your hand up in front of you. Now, there's one curious feature of the hand that's not quite obvious unless you actually try to look at it carefully. If you hold your hand palm up in front of you, and if you happen to be a man, you notice that the first finger is relatively short, then the next finger is a long finger, and the third finger is a little longer than the first finger. So in men, the ring finger tends to be a little longer than the index finger. If you happen to be a woman, however, that's often reversed. The index finger tends to be a little longer than the third finger. So there's a subtle sexual dimorphism or sex difference in the anatomy of the hand. I don't know if this has any particular functional significance. It's a very minor thing, but it seems to be true not only in human beings, but also in other animals like rats. So this sexual dimorphism in hand anatomy probably is related to the exposure of the skeleton to sex hormones during development, which tends to promote slight differences in bony anatomy. There are other sex differences in the skeleton which are much more obvious. For example, the pelvic bones of the female tend to be flatter and broader than the pelvic bones of the male. This sexual dimorphism in bone anatomy is not restricted to the hand, but it's also present in some other bones of the body. For example, the pelvic bones of males tend to be different in appearance from females. Female pelvis has bones that are flatter and broader than males. And this, of course, has a very important functional consequence. This allows for a greater capacity of the pelvic cavity and allows for childbirth in females. This is not only found in humans, but it's also present in lots of other different creatures. Even rats have slight sex differences in pelvic anatomy. And generally, the skeleton of a male can be distinguished from the skeleton of a female.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.